my complete pleasure to be interviewing these two absolute luminaries in the field of clinical psychology, relationship research. I mean, they just don't get more influential, more impactful than this. We'll be spending most of the time today talking about their new book, this wonderful book, highly recommended, 8 Dates, Essential Conversations for a Lifetime of Love. The dates serve different functions. For example, you will, if you go on all these dates, and I think you should, trust and commitment, addressing conflict, sex and intimacy. That's a good date. Work and money, family, fun and adventure, growth and spirituality and dreams. So we'll spend most of the day talking about that, or most of the next hour. Before we launch into the details of this book, the introductory biography was terrific in terms of hitting the high notes. Can you give us just a little bit of background on the two of you in particular? How did you start working together to build what is, as far as I can tell, a complete ecosystem of clinical therapy, not only treating patients, but developing the interventions to treat the patients, training other clinicians to treat the patients, continuing to do world-class research? Could you give us a little bit of a sense of the background, how that all started?
Okay. So here's how we started. First of all, John was at the University of Illinois, and John, I'll let you tell that part. Isn't that fabulous? He did his best research in your state, if you're from Illinois, which is totally cool. I was in California doing graduate work, came north, he came west, we met in Seattle, fell in love instantly. And I had been doing mostly individual work. So I had worked with heroin addicts in the combat zone in Boston. I'd worked with people who were schizophrenic. I had worked with folks who really struggled with very serious PTSD. I'd worked a lot with couples in poverty. You know, so I like a little bit of a challenge, just a wee bit. And I also worked with cancer patients and their families. So. I was in private practice when John and I met, and John was doing this stellar research, which he'll talk about in just a moment. And we met, we married about 11 months later, which was amazing. And I just have to tell you one tiny little story, which is that the way John proposed to me was, "What do you think about the idea of marriage?" And I thought, "What?"
Write that down.
I was. And of course, a good Chinese restaurant, right? So we're eating Chinese. I said, "What? What do you mean?" Turned out to be a proposal. So I thought about it for a really long time, like 45 seconds, and then I said yes. So 9 years later, we were out in a kayak, I think, or a canoe, out in the Pacific Ocean, just having our usual kind of lovely paddle. And John had been doing this incredible research, and I'd been trying desperately to keep myself separate from him and failing miserably because I really wanted to hear about the research. So we'd talk about it at night, much to our daughter's dismay and boredom. And out in this canoe, I said, you know, we've got to take this stuff out of the ivory tower. Let's build interventions. Let's build theory and interventions. And from that moment on, we began to work at it, creating interventions together, creating theory together, testing the interventions, and created the Gottman Institute about 23 years ago. So we've been working and refining it, and we are dedicated, like strongly dedicated, to our work being research-based. So that it's not based on opinion, speculation, you know, our own brilliance, which, you know, is negligible. It's actually based on what the great couples who volunteered for the research taught us. Your turn.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're right.
Write that down, too. Yeah?
Okay, next question.
Mark Twain once said, "My wife knows everything that can be known, but I know the rest." I've kept track of my research hypotheses for about 3 years. I kept track of them and put them away and then analyzed the data. And it turns out I am wrong 60% of the time, mostly wrong, So if we didn't do research, we'd think we were right 100% of the time, right? But mostly we're wrong. And, you know, and it's kind of fun, really, to learn, you know, from doing experiments. And, you know, and we really enjoy telling couples all the ways in which we're wrong and, you know, how the data really informed us about, you know, how to move forward. But none of this would have happened without her clinical experience, because she was a real clinician, really trained. I was trained at the University of Wisconsin to do enough, have enough clinical skills so I wasn't embarrassing to the university. But they really wanted me to do research, and that's what I enjoyed. So how do you measure things like whether two people love each other? How do you measure things like, you know, is the relationship going to last? So Bob Levinson, my lifetime collaborator, who's a professor of psychology at UC Berkeley, and I got together. And when we started working together, both of our relationships with women were really not going well. We went from one disaster to another. So basically, before Julie, two clueless guys decided to study relationships. And we were totally stunned that we were able to predict the future of relationships from the things we measured. Things like how fast people's hearts were beating, how fast their blood was flowing, you know, and discovered, you know, very simple things. Like, and this one finding has become really famous in Seattle. So, and it was the 5-to-1 ratio that in great relationships, during conflict, there's 5 times as much positivity as negativity. You know, there's 5 times as much interest, affection, humor, you know, understanding, compassion, as there is hostility, anger, disappointment, sadness. And I tell you, in my relationships, this is before Julie, if there had been as much negativity as positivity, I would have been happy. That would have been a great relationship.
You were underwater.
My experience, yeah, right. Yeah. And so I was stunned that it was 5-to-1. And a couple of weeks ago, I was leaving a Starbucks in Seattle, and a truck rolled by, and the guy rolled down his window, and he said, 5-to-1, right? I said, right. So at least in Seattle, people have heard of this ratio.
I mean, the 5-to-1 ratio, like if, you know, if you're a relationship scientist, if you study this stuff for a living, the 5-to-1 ratio is like, since I saw her standing there, and like the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse is just some other Beatles tune, right? These are just absolute classics. I do think we could take one lesson from this conversation, which is that even if you study romantic relationships for a living, your child will still think you're boring. All right. Let's move on and talk about the book. So the first sentence of the book intrigued me. Every great love story is a never-ending conversation. And you do go on in the book to unpack it, but would you share for us a little bit what you mean when you say a never-ending conversation?
So what that means is that as human beings, first of all, we are pack animals. We need to connect with one another. We are dependent on each other. We need to express our needs to each other, which is something that's very, very difficult for us to do, especially as Americans who, yeah, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, you don't need anybody, ha, ha, ha. Yeah. Not true. We totally need each other, and we need to be expressing that. But the other thing, too, is that we are marked by our experiences and continually evolving and changing, growing, sometimes devolving, and then moving forward again. So the best relationships are one in which you are staying in tune with one another. You are sharing the ways that you're going through life, you're moving through time, you're experiencing both your joys, your strivings, your triumphs, your failures. Those are the best relationships where you don't have to keep it all inside. You share it with one another.
Yeah, I tell you the story of how I met Julie. So after a divorce, about 7 years after I got divorced, I moved to the University of Washington in Seattle. I decided, okay, I got there in May, school starts in October. I'm gonna take this dating thing really seriously. I'm gonna just, that's all I'm gonna do is date. And I dated 60 women in 10 weeks, okay? That's all I did was date. And, you know, so I had a database, you know. Julie was number 61. So I'm sitting in a coffee house. You know, this hasn't been a very good summer. another disaster, one after another, right? And she walks in, and I have the guts to go over to her and say, would you like to have a cup of coffee with me? And she says, okay. And we sit down, and the conversation has never ended. Right?
So sweet.
And last
so
night
sweet.
We heard about Eli and Allison and how they met. And what Allison said was they were put together by their grandmothers. Their grandmothers fixed them up.
She also said that the only reason why she thinks we worked is that the expectations were so low.
So low.
She did say that.
Very important. That's a very important part.
That's basically the
My
secret.
My expectations were very low after 60 women, failing with 60 women, right?
So it wasn't tough to actually win his heart, right? The other, I have to throw in one little thing, this is a really great piece of research that I'm very excited about that we didn't do, but I found out that people who are really neurotic can have great marriages, and it was like, yes, I was thrilled.
Right,
so,
exactly.
Yeah, I'm the neurotic one.
And for
one.
Them, when they got together, put together by their grandmothers, Allison said it was a never-ending conversation.
It's true.
Yeah.
Enough about me. So there's been a series of very highly selling books called Don't Sweat the Small Stuff, or I forget, something like Don't Sweat the Small Stuff. And I'm certainly not asking you to chime in on those. I don't know if you've read it. But one of the things that jumped out at me in reading your book is how much you focus on the small stuff. And I think I jotted a couple notes. Successful long-term relationships are created through small words, small gestures, and small acts over time.
Yeah.
I easily could have imagined the opposite hypothesis that says, don't worry about the day-to-day stuff, but every year right. you're going to have one or two moments that are really going to matter, right? But it seems like you guys have a different philosophy, understanding about how marriage works and how to, relationships more generally, how these things work and how to cultivate a very strong one. Why is it that we should focus so much on the small stuff?
Well, here's where that evolved from. We had an apartment lab at the University of Washington where couples would come to stay for 24 hours. And we designed it to be just like a B&B. You know, it was really beautiful. It had a TV, a nice sofa bed. It had a kitchen. You could make all your own meals and so on. People would come for 24 hours for this lovely B&B experience, except there were three cameras bolted to the walls that videotaped every second of their life together. We took their urine. We took their blood. They wore Holter monitors, you know, to measure three channels of cardiac activity and, you know, a few other things. But other than that, it was like a total B&B. B&B, right? So, we found out that, you know, in watching many, many, you know, hundreds, thousands of hours of videotape, we found out that couples would make little bits for connection. So one partner would be looking out the window and say something like, wow, what a beautiful boat. Mm-hmm. And the other person could do one of three things. Could simply say, stop interrupting me, I'm trying to read, which we call turning against. Or could say nothing, would just flip the page, turning away. Or they could look out the window and go, huh. And that made all the difference in the world in terms of how the relationship would go 6 years down the road. Little tiny moments of turning towards each other. So we found that the successful couples, the ones 6 years down the road who did well, turned towards each other 86% of the time. The ones who did badly and ended up either very unhappy or divorcing, 33% of the time. Huge difference. So as a result, you know, what we've seen, again, based on the research, is that those little, tiny, small moments of either turning towards each other or expressing appreciation like thanks for emptying the dishwasher, or saying, you know, you are so kind. I love watching you with our child. Little moments like that make a huge difference in the success of the relationship.
The other thing was that we discovered a secret. So in trying to predict which newlywed couples would last and which ones wouldn't, turned out when we studied them just a couple of months after their wedding, the amount of shared humor made a huge difference. Mm-hmm. Couples who could laugh together, you know, especially when their heart rates got high, mm-hmm. heart rates would go down with shared humor. And that finding, that shared humor really reduces physiological arousal, has been replicated. So, but it wasn't a lot of humor. You know, it was maybe, 30 seconds more in the couples that stayed together and the couples that didn't, but it was highly significant, very mm-hmm. predictive. Mm-hmm. So how do you get couples to laugh during conflict? And people have tried, said, okay, next time you talk about his mother, raise your lip corners and go, ha, 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 ha. You know, it doesn't work, right? No, it turns out that first we found the correlation that people who turned toward these bids more had more shared humor. And then we did the experiment, and it turns out if you increase turning toward these small bids, these small moments, humor suddenly emerges during conflict automatically. I don't know why. I don't know what the mechanism is.
Maybe we look really silly when we're arguing. We have to look at each other. We think it's funny.
Right. But you've turned toward one another. You have this emotional cushion, I think, mm-hmm. you know, this bank account with a lot of deposits in it.
I mean, I'll say that John and Julie Gottman are, I think, at the very top of people who have really invested time observing couples interacting. And each time I go back and reread something I read before, it actually does affect how I behave in my marriage. In fact, it's probably been a savior. I mean, but this idea of a bid seems very, very small. But I will tell you that when I came back to that and saw it for the first time again in a few years, it changed my behavior in one very small way, but I think a not trivial way, which was I'm often on the couch, with my computer, prepping for a lecture, writing something, when my wife comes in and, you know, comes back from work or something like that. And I don't think I had noticed that my default is to, like, finish the thing I was doing. I was in the middle of some thought, I'm going to finish that or whatever else. And now my wife comes in and says, hey, how are you doing? And I shut the computer. Just symbolically, I don't know if it makes much of a difference whether the computer screen is still up and I'm looking at her or whether I've actually shut it. But this is the sort of thing that I have changed in my own relationship, in my own marriage, because I've paid attention to what happens when you study literally tens of thousands of couples and you can actually develop these little tricks that I'm convinced make a difference, and I'm applying them in my own life.
Yeah.
Speaking of little tricks, so one of the things you do, we're about to get to this, we're going to get to the specific dates after this, but one of the other things you do at the front end as you're sort of setting up, you know, why the dates, why these 8 dates in general when you go on these dates, what are sort of more constructive, less constructive ways to approach them, you talk about 4 skills of intimate conversation, and you lay them out, and you're very specific, like how do we very specifically go about developing each of these skills. You also talk about the art of listening, and in both, and in pretty much all of your work, you're very, very specific, concrete about how individuals, regular people, can inform our own and our own interaction and behave a little bit more constructively. Would you maybe give us, I know that the full story is in the book, would you maybe give us a little bit of a teaser of either one of the skills for intimate conversation or one of the key elements of the art of listening, or perhaps maybe one of you could take each one of those and just a feel for the sort of stuff that's in the book.
Sure. One of the things that we've seen that is really, really important is what we call attunement. And what we mean by attunement is listening to each other's emotions. So how many of you feel really comfortable sharing sadness? Raise your hands. Cool. How about anger?
It's like my favorite.
How about fear? How about joy? Cool. Great. So, you know, what we have seen is that when partners express those emotions to one another, even if they're doing so as a complaint to the other about the other's, you know, behavior or how the other's actions are influencing them, if they describe their own emotion about it, saying something like, for example, I'm really worried that the bills haven't been paid. So notice, you're not saying, I'm really worried because you are so lazy you haven't paid the bills, right? Not okay. That's criticism. There is no such thing as constructive criticism. So instead, saying something like, I'm really worried about what? What's the situation? The bills haven't been paid. And then saying what you need and saying your positive need. I would love it if you would pay the bills tonight. So the positive need is, how can the partner shine for you? When you express things like that, then your partner can attune to you, can say, I hear you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're worried. I get it. That makes sense to me. Let me do that after dinner. I'll pay the bills after dinner. It's much easier for somebody to listen with attunement to your emotions if, as a speaker, you're describing those emotions rather than couching them inside criticism, which doesn't work.
Anything you'd like to add to that?
It's pretty good, I think, you know, it's pretty good.
Not bad.
Yeah.
A B. I get a B.
Well, I think for me, those four skills are really easy to learn. Mm-hmm. And they're so rare.
Yeah.
You know, even if you're at cocktail parties, Jean Piaget talked about a thing called collective monologue in children. And you do see it sometimes in children. One child will say, a four-year-old child will say, my dolly is so sleepy, she has to go to bed. And the other child will say, I'm drawing the sky blue. And the first kid will say, she hasn't slept in days. And the next child will say, maybe I'll color it green, you know. So they each have their own monologue. But actually, I see that often in cocktail parties among adults. Everybody's broadcasting.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know. So the four skills were, the first one is kind of surprising. It may not think of this as a skill, but that the ability to put your own feelings in words in a way that is true to your body. And a guy named Eugene Jandlin really figured this out. He wrote a great book called Focusing. And, you know, and it's really knowing that your body is telling you what you feel. And if you're consistent with your feelings, you've got a lot to say. And your body, in a way, is a guide. It's your own GPS in the world. And your partner wants to know what you're feeling, wants to know you. So that skill is about not staying hidden or invisible. The second skill is asking open-ended questions, which is a big thing in this book. Mm-hmm. Asking questions that open the heart. Not, did you pay the plumber? Mm-hmm. But how would you like our life to be in 3 years from now? Mm-hmm. That kind of question. And then the third skill is really just like that, but it's saying things. It doesn't have to be a question. Like, tell me the story of that. When did that start? When did that, you know, what's the story of how you became a psychologist? Mm-hmm. Kind of what you asked us at the very beginning, mm-hmm. Yep. You know. And the fourth skill is empathy, is really being compassionate. And as Julie points out, you know, that's hard when she's mad at me or she's disappointed in me. It's hard for me to really listen well and apply those four skills. So I have a little notebook in my back pocket. And this one has rainbows and unicorns on it, which calms me down. And when she says the four most terrifying words in the English language, we need to talk. I take out my notebook and I look at the unicorns and rainbows and I'm thinking, oh no. I didn't want to spend the evening this way. But what I say is, talk to me, baby. I'm taking notes.
And because he's taking notes and we write books together, I have to be really careful what I say,
yeah.
Right?
Right.
It may wind up in a book.
I've got some real doozies that she said in here.
That contradicts what we said on page 86. All right, the dates. 8, I presume, is not a number that came at random. I presume there was some process of generating date ideas, looking at data, sending people out actually to go on these dates, and distilling down what you think are the really most essential ones. I'm sure you could have come up with more, but it looks like you have settled on these 8 because you think these are in their own category of importance. What was the process of coming up with this particular set of dates?
Well, we have worked with couples for a really, really long time. We've seen over 50,000 couples in workshops. We've seen couples individually as well. And what we were trying to do is two things. One, we were trying to create a book that would help the couples who've been together, you know, maybe for decades, for a long time, who were both so busy, dual career couples, that they didn't stay in tune with each other over the years. They'd lost touch with each other. They would have to-do lists they would discuss, like what was found at the Sloan Center at UCLA, where dual career couples would spend 35 minutes a week talking to each other. That was it. So we wanted to create a book for couples like that who had grown really, really distant. And we had known that those couples hadn't talked about their dreams, hadn't talked about, oh, maybe the values that underlay what they did in terms of money. They hadn't talked about trust and commitment. They maybe didn't ever talk about sex and intimacy. They just did it. They didn't talk about it, or were afraid to talk about what they wanted, and so on. We also wrote this book for couples who were just dating and getting to know one another. And, you know, if you recall, when you were first dating, there might have been some time back there, where you were nervous as all get out, right? And you didn't know what to talk about, and there were those terrible, awkward silences, and you wouldn't know what to do, and so you'd say, gosh, isn't that a great band, you know, and there's no comeback for that. So, you know, what do you say? So we wanted to write a book for folks like that, too, to really get to know each other at a much deeper level, like, who are you, really, right? But we wanted to do it in a way that was safe for people. Really safe. We didn't want to set up conflicts. We wanted people instead to talk about things, for example, like the chapter on money, which asked, okay, so how did your family growing up deal with money? What value did they place on making money? How much money was enough? Right? Did they like to spend more money or save more money? Did you grow up with this sense of real, you know, paucity of money? Or did things always seem so wonderfully, perfectly comfortable? How did you grow up? And how do you value money now? What does money mean to you? So money can mean so many things, right? It can mean freedom, power, security, insecurity. What does money mean to you? So we were asking questions like that. We started with 11 dates, something like that, that we had seen were really important conversations that couples either needed to have or were having in successful relationships. And we sent 300 couples on these dates, and they audiotaped the dates. We also had webinars with those couples to get their feedback on the dates.
Did they audiotape the sex date?
Yeah.
They did, because it's all about conversation.
As you were.
Where is your mind?
I think it's somewhere.
So, he's younger than we are, right? So, anyway, so they talked about, you know, how did you learn about sex? Well, I have one of the great stories of all time about learning about sex. And so when I shared that with John, it was great. You know, it was in a car with my mom when my older brothers, 5 and 7 years older with me, were talking about something. I asked a question somehow distantly related to sex, or at least they thought it was. And they said to Mom, you've got to talk to her. You haven't talked to her. We were in downtown Portland, Oregon, busiest street in the town. It was about 100 degrees outside. She rolled up the windows of the car and parked when, so it became like 140 degrees. We're both like passing out. And she's talking about Peter. I have no idea of who that is. I don't know what she's talking about. So, you know, it's stuff like that that you can share with each other that's really fun.
Right.
And then talk about what your preferences are, how you want things to be in this relationship here and now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was fun listening to 2,400 dates.
I imagine.
You know.
Yeah.
These people going on these dates. And, the date on trust and commitment is number one, you know, and you'd think that'd be a really unpleasant date. Talk about, you know, trust and commitment. But boy, it was the most interesting date of all. And people really got into it, because the one thing that people are afraid of is that they can't trust this person, you know, if they're dating this person, or even if they're in a long-term relationship. Yeah. Can they really trust this person they're with? And that's what all the arguments were about among newlyweds in my lab. Can I trust you?
I actually have a question I'd like to ask you guys about that, but before I do you have your own favorite dates? Was it the same one for each of you?
Very different, actually. Very different. Do you want to start, sweetie?
Well, my favorite date is the one on play and fun and adventure, you know, because I've just finished analyzing data from 40,000 couples who took our questionnaire checkup, our relationship checkup online. And these were all couples who were about to start couples therapy around the world. And turned out that 80% of them said that fun and play and adventure had died in their relationship. They just had no fun together. I thought that was so sad. And so in this date, people actually sit and talk about, you know, what their bucket list is, what they really want to do before they die, what adventures they actually dream of having, and how to have more fun in their relationship. And a lot of times couples have had a lot of fun together when they were first courting, and they just, their relationships became this very long to-do list that was about children and work and all the things we have to do every day to really survive, you know, and they just weren't having a good time with each other. And, you know, so I thought that date was so interesting because it revived fun and play. Just to talk about it, just to say, let's do that. So you want to do that? I want to do that. Let's do that. Let's make a time.
One brief thing on that. One of the things I liked in the book is there's a number of places where you guys talk openly about your own personal experiences.
Right.
And the chapter on this sort of play and adventure date was really interesting because you guys have very different preferences or default preferences
on what
sounds like
different
fun, right, where you're like a colossal nerd.
Yeah.
And you're a big adventurer. Do you want to talk briefly about that? And then, yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
So, Eli, you and I have this in common because Eli loves to climb mountains, and so do I. So I love mountain climbing. I love backpacking. The higher the altitude, the better. And conversely, John gets altitude sick on a ladder. So we like to call him an indoorsman. He has special clothing,
right,
you know, that he likes to wear.
As the special clothing for indoorsman.
Sweatpants?
Silk bathrobe, you know. The.
You got to try Lululemon. You can upgrade.
Ooh, yeah. So his clothes are not from REI. Mine are. And so, you know, we have these huge differences. So we needed to find something that we could do that was together at sea level. So we did.
Right.
We found kayaking. So John loves the sea. I love the sea. I'll do anything outside. And so we kayak.
Right.
And love it together. So.
And we don't instruct one another.
Very important.
Just enjoy.
Very important. Mm-hmm. That's right. So even if you're totally incompatible, all that stuff about you have to be compatible to have a good relationship, not true. It's a big myth.
She's a lot more incompatible than I am.
Okay, for everything
Wait
that you wrote down,
minute.
Erase it. Erase at least one thing you wrote down before in light of that. which was your favorite of the dates?
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming back to that.
Yeah.
My favorite was dreams. So when we talk about dreams, you know, well, I really anchor that in here and now today. You know, how many of us have gone through the Great Recession, maybe have gone through some losses during that time, or maybe came from backgrounds where our dreams were not honored. They weren't listened to. They weren't even allowed to be spoken, let alone listened to and honored. So one of the things I adore is that no matter what somebody's IQ, no matter what somebody's education, everyone is a philosopher. Everyone is looking for a way to give their life meaning and purpose. And having dreams where we can go have an adventure or do something magnificent that has a mission to it, a purpose to it, which is our dream, is something that we really deeply need to connect with our partner about and to share with our partner. And it's one of the most powerful parts of the work that we do with couples when they're distressed, to help couples to talk about their dreams and see how they can honor each other's dreams.
I think we have time for one more question before we do Q&A. So I'd like to pick up on what you were talking about earlier in terms of issues with trust and insecurity. The first date you have in the book is about commitment and trust. And it really struck me how seriously the book takes the fear, the insecurity that can come along with true intimacy. And you know, it's one of the things that's long interested me too, is this idea of the sort of like the kiss of the porcupines. That's that Schopenhauer parable that you want to get close to feel nice and warm, but then you get stuck by the quill and you pull apart a little bit.
Yeah.
And there's this tension between real intimacy and self-protection, and you really can't optimize on both.
Right.
And you guys are very, very honest about that. I mean, in one space you say staying in love takes a level of vulnerability that isn't always comfortable. Later, you say there's no question that committing to a person is a terrifying prospect. It means putting all our eggs in one basket. There is no safety net. Later still, committing to a relationship requires a level of vulnerability that can be way more frightening than anything Alice ever encountered in Wonderland. It's relevant in context, I assure you. Yeah. In fact, you even refer to the dates as experiments in vulnerability. And so I wonder if you could just, you know, by way of taking us to the Q&A section, could you talk a little bit about the inherent tension that says the only way you can have real intimacy and real closeness is to make yourself very, very vulnerable. But the only way you can feel infinitely protected is to not let yourself get that close. So how is it that people can navigate that, and how is it that they can feel enough self-confidence, enough of a sense of confidence in the partner to be able to take maximal advantages of the 8 dates that are in this book?
Okay.
What a great question.
Yeah, that's a wonderful question, Eli. Thank you. Yeah, very thoughtful. So first of all, what we realized, John did some research on trust and betrayal. And what we realized is that you create trust in little tiny tests, little tiny baby steps of, will you be there for me? Will you be there for me when I'm in a bad mood? When I'm happy and want to celebrate, when I'm sick, when I'm depressed, when I'm on the ground with hopelessness, when I've just watched CNN.
Could be worse.
Fill in
Could be worse.
The gap here. When, you know, I've had a really stressful day, will you be there for me when I'm exhausted? So, you know, in relationships, all of us are insecure. All of us have self-preservation instincts, right? All of us want the safety of a loving connection with somebody. And it takes courage to enter into that, will you be there for me? And try. So there's little baby steps you can take on the way. Things like, will your partner call you when she or he says they'll call you? Will they show up when they say they're going to show up? Will they listen if you want to talk about your stresses, or will they change the subject? If you want to talk about your upset, your sadness, your grief, or your joy for that matter, your celebration because you just got, you know, a promotion, will they be there? So all of those little baby steps are ways of seeing, is your partner there for you? And that's how you build trust. Now, in terms of self-protection, one of the things that we've often seen is that every single person is ultimately human, ultimately flawed, ultimately making mistakes, sometimes huge mistakes, sometimes little mistakes. Okay. Are they willing to repair those mistakes? Are they willing to take responsibility for them? That's where you begin to create the safety. Because when somebody cares enough about you to say, I'm so deeply sorry that I hurt you that way. I am so sorry. And they do that without making excuses, without explaining it right off the bat. I was just tired. Don't take it seriously. Well, no. That's invalidating your emotions about it, right? They should take it seriously. And so should you. So, yes, we're flawed. Yes, we make mistakes. But do people make repairs? That in itself is incredibly important in building trust and creating that safety for us.
Sort of like an incremental process and
that's
then a
right.
personal one. Anything you want
to
add?
Well,
right.
trust is also something that happens when you're not together. Mm-hmm. So, am I thinking of Julie when she's not there as well as myself? And again, in very small moments, this is something that happens. So, for example, I have learned over time what a clean kitchen means to her. It is not the same as what a clean kitchen meant to me.
Amen.
When I lived alone.
It took me a decade to discover this one.
Okay, right. So we're.
I also learned it.
We're brothers here. Yeah. So, you know, so I get up first and I make the coffee and empty the dishwasher and, you know, and prepare. You know, sometimes prepare breakfast for both of us, sometimes just for me. And she comes in later into the kitchen. And I know how to prepare that kitchen so she doesn't notice anything wrong. You know, I'm thinking about her even when she's not there. And that's a lot of what trust is, you know, is that both people are thinking about the benefits for both of them, not just for themselves, just trying to maximize your own benefits in life. You're thinking about what your partner needs as well. Yeah. So I think that's an important part of trust.
Oh, yeah.
The commitment part, you know, we really learned about from your mentor, Carol Rusbald, who is a brilliant social psychologist who spent 30 years teaching us about how only if you put all your eggs in one basket do you get all the benefits of a loving relationship. And my former student, Jim Cohen, who has studied the effects of holding hands with somebody that you trust when you're scared, and the whole fear system in the brain shuts down. And that only happens when people are committed to one another. That's an amazing benefit. So you only get the benefits of a great relationship, which are enormous: longevity, better health, better resilience, faster recovery from illness, greater wealth. And your children turn out better. You only get that when you put all your eggs in one basket, which is terrifying to do.
Mm-hmm. All right, I think it's a good moment to open it up. Yeah. Do we get a preliminary
round
of applause for them?
Thank you.